Guten Abend. Good evening. Danke fürs Kommen. Thank you for coming tonight. We appreciate a lot. It's a very interesting and new situation for everybody, but most of all, I thank Wendy for coming the long way to join us. And I think it's a very special situation to sit inside the work of this project Wendy Ewald did in the context of the Thisplace exhibition and project. And we will start with a more general view on the work of Wendy, because I think this is very important to understand the very specific approach she took on working in Israel and the West Bank. Just a brief, very brief introduction. I think we will come later during the talk to some more biographical aspects. Wendy is an artist and photographer. Obviously, she was director of the mountain photography workshop in Apple Shop in Kentucky, and she did a very interesting work on people, mostly on women in the Appalachians, in the mountain area. She was a research scholar at Duke University and a senior fellow at the New School, and an artist residence in Amherst College. I think this is shows a bit the reputation of her work. And now talking, preparing this discussion, we've been talking a bit of an older work, and we've been browsing a bit through this catalog, which is called Secret Games. I just learned that there is a German version, Geheime Spiele, which was published in the frame of an exhibition at the Winterthur Museum in Switzerland. And oh, Wendy, could you please open it? But then we marked it. And we stopped at a very interesting photograph, and then Wendy started to explain. We don't see actually a photography. We will pass the book around, so this is also like we also trying to integrate a bit of participatory elements in the night. So, and it's a picture, and then we see some black parts and we see some white parts that are painted over on top of the photography. And there is a writing white self. And I would like now Wendy, I take over, we change say some words about the project, in which frame, when did it happen, where did it happen, and what do we see? Thank you.
Well, I'm not sure. Is it on? Yeah. It was in the 90s. I think it was over a period of time, and the time period is very important because there were two communities in Durham, North Carolina, were the African American community and the white community, but there was one community, but there were two school systems, one for African Americans almost entirely, and the other for mostly for whites. And after years and years and years, they finally voted the community to merge them into one system. And I was working with students there in the two different communities, and was aware that the students were very worried about what was going to happen on both sides. So I tried to think about what I could do, because I was trying to do projects with teachers and the students in those schools that had something to do with their own lives and what was going on, their concerns. And so I thought about how I could use black and white photography with them to make something about black and white relationships in that community. And I just kind of saw it. I saw these pictures in my mind, which is bizarre, but I did. And so then I tried to, and I do this a lot actually, try to design an educational process that would bring the people I was working with along with me so that we could make it together, so that, you know, they were in their ideas and they were informed about, you know, why we were doing what we were doing. And so I asked them to write self-portraits, which I do a lot, the people I work with, and then to write another self-portrait as if they were a member of another ethnic group. But at that time, there were only African Americans predominantly and whites in Durham, North Carolina. And so they ended up calling this project White Self, Black Self. So they wrote a self-portrait as their own self and then as a member of the other group. And then from that, they made, with me, they made self-portraits as both of those people. And so they brought in clothes from home, whatever. And then after that process, I was shooting them, but they were, you know, designing it, choosing sites, et cetera. I gave them the negatives, and I had etching tools and Sharpies so that they could alter the negative however they wanted to further make those two portraits. So that's how you get, that's a African-American boy who is himself there, and then he's being a white person there. But those placed with the texts are often surprisingly revealing. I mean, it was very exciting actually to do. I mean, it completely changed my mind about this community and who these kids were. And then it ended up being something that teachers then started doing at the University of North Carolina. They worked on this project with teaching fellows before they went into the classroom.
So quoting you, you said, I asked my collaborators to alter my images by drawing or writing on them, challenging the concept of who actually makes the image, who is the photographer, who is the subject, who is the observer, and who is the observed. What's the difference if you come to a community, to a situation as an outsider? Is this important to be an outsider, or what happens in these moments?
Well, I think it is in one sense, because you can do things as an outsider that insiders cannot do, and I think a lot of us know that. I know I can remember an African-American teacher telling me, you know, this is really, you know, she was very taken with the project, but she said, I could never have done that because I am too black. And there's a kind of neutrality that you have. I don't know if it's neutrality, but you have a position that you don't have if you're a member of that community. But at the same time, I think it doesn't matter whether you're, you know, what I'm interested in is then designing a process so that we're doing it together, and designing a process so that their ideas can come out and into the work. And that's the, I don't know, that's part of the craft, I guess.
These designing of a process is at the moment also very relevant for our work as museum curators. We do challenge, we are a lot this issue. We also right now we show an exhibition, AS in Jewish. You can still see it in the new part, in the basement of the building, where we worked a lot with students to create this exhibition. And we came, the most challenging part then was to decide what to show. during the process, there are lots of ideas and lots of ways you're working with children, with a lot of, so it goes wild, then you have a lot. But the decision process is, I think, the most interesting and intriguing part. If you design a process like this, how does it come to this moment of decisions or...
Yeah, that's an interesting question because on the one hand, you know, it's always the tightening up, the loosening, the tightening, the loosening. And for me, I need an organizing myth, you know, to start with. And, you know, in the case of this project, well, this project is really interesting to talk about, actually, because, first of all, I'm going to answer all your questions you had right now. First of all, I really didn't want to do it. I felt very conflicted.
So now you're talking about this place. Exhibition.
Sorry.
Yeah. No, just
this
two.
Place. Yeah. But then it was really intriguing at the same time. But then we were promised that we could go on an exploratory trip, and I thought, well, okay, you know, I can do that without making, you know, a commitment. But the trip we went on was very conflicted, and it was a very interesting process, and I wish I had been a better writer that I could have written it down. We were the first people to go. There were five of us. We bonded. We felt like we were members of one of those survivor shows. You know, who was going to go next, or who was going to get in trouble, or do the wrong thing, or whatever it was.
So to understand better. So how did it begin? Who did contact you with proposal
yeah.
to?
Yes. Okay. That's. Well, so Frederick Brenner got in touch with me. I think very early on in his conception of the project. And he was very intrigued by the idea of having someone work from within communities or in the way that he had never seen my work before, and it intrigued him. So that's how that happened initially, and then there were... he kept accumulating, you know, different artists he was interested in, and so... But five of us went to Israel... Martin Kolar and Nick Woplington and I, and then there were two other artists who then weren't asked because not everybody was asked either. So it was a process. It was definitely an interesting process to go through. And at first I really was very even when I came back I didn't know whether I would do it or not. And finally, I thought, no, my husband convinced me, actually, to do it.
So what made it so different for you? Because going also through your past projects, you worked all around the world in South Africa, in Mexico. Mm-hmm. So what made working in Israel so different for you? And also what made you also in the first moment to think, no, I won't participate, perhaps?
I think it was because I didn't know how to think about, you know, I was being asked to go to Israel. I wasn't asked to be, I mean, I'm very interested in cracks, you know, between, you know, in communities. And I think that was what I was interested in. And I didn't know how I could do it in the way that wasn't too loaded or stereotypical. So that was really my problem. And then, but once I got there and started working, as soon as I started working, it was okay. But, you know, conceptualizing it was very difficult for me. And the first place I went to was Nazareth, and I felt comfortable in Nazareth. So I thought, okay, I'm going to go to a place where I feel comfortable and see, you know, see what happens. And I'm going to just do what I've done before and see if something different comes, because I don't like the idea of just sort of repeating, you know, a project. And the first pictures I saw come out, which were that those right there at the end of this wall, that's Nazareth, I thought were extraordinary. And they showed me things that I had no, you know, I didn't know about. The way they were using the camera was really interesting. And then I thought, then from there, I went to the girls, the girls, Mejina, the pre-army school, which I guess is down there, you know, to see what, you know, a very different group of young people would photograph. And those were extraordinary. You know, so I just thought, oh, well, okay, this is really pretty resolved. And I remember the artist Mickey Kratzman saying to me, well, look, this is resolved. You've done this. What are you going to do now? And so then I finally then become much more conscious of how many different groups. And people started asking me, will you come work here? Will you come work there? And I said, no, I can't. You know, that's too many things. I can't do all that. And then finally I realized that was really, that I was being asked to do something and that's what I should follow. And then it became conscious, like how many, there's 7 groups of Arabs, Muslims, and 7 groups of Jews. And then I thought about how I could sort of make, so all the, all those colors of the text, they all have a meaning to them. So it went from something very unconscious to something very conscious.
To learn a bit more how you worked, how did you involve people? How did you, who did prepare it, or how did, when you arrived at these different places, what happened first, what happened second?
Mm-hmm. Well, it was very well prepared, actually, because I am a teacher too, and I'm, you know, know how to sort of sequence things in that way. So it was all about what do you see in a photograph? And so we looked at pictures. I talked to them about what they'd taken pictures of or why did they want to be part of this? Because they all chose to be part of this. So to set the kind of stage before, and then we worked with the camera, same camera that all the kids had. I lent them all, or kids. They weren't just kids. They were adults. They were elderly women. They were very different populations. And so before they took a camera home to shoot, they were very adept at using the camera. We talked about framing, point of view, but in a... you know, not in a doctrinaire way, but just, you know, you got to learn that you can look up, you can look from side to side. There's no right composition, but these are things that you can do with the machine. And then after that, I would give them assignments in the beginning.
Have you been surprised by the pictures, or was it after doing these kind of projects in different places, did you somehow see what people bring up, or is there perhaps an example where you were really surprised? Wow, this came out now of this process as a group. So, is there an example?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, if I go back to the Nazareth one, there, I mean, they're very different, the pictures within there, but there are things like that close up of the doll's face. Or the flower, and then on the other hand, you have much more documentary things like the imam praying, the strange things like the girl who's drawing a picture of a white girl, or the gun with the bird made out of shells. I mean, the details in them, I thought were phenomenal. the still lives that they made, and it was predominant in the Arab pictures. The still lives were very prominent. A lot of pictures of food. I mean, I could sort of go on about that, but those are things that I discovered, you know, when I started looking at them. And the big hurdle was editing, of course, because these were, since they're digital, this is the first digital project I ever did. There are, you know, maybe 50 to 100,000 images or something like that. And so what I would do, I went maybe eight times or quite, I went quite a few times, and I would have these projects going on at once, maybe not all of them at once, but a lot of them. And so I would go from place to place and, you know, download things and talk, and we'd talk and critique pictures and new ideas, and then I would go home to New York, and then I would start looking and, you know, do a rough edit, and then bring that rough edit back, and then they would write the captions that you see on the sides. They would write the captions for them, and if there were any pictures they didn't want to be used, they would put big X's over the pictures, and so it was a process like that. But I felt that I was in the head of each kid that I looked at when I was looking at it. I mean, it was wonderful, but it was a lot of work.
What was the main difference? Because when you talk about Netherlands, I'm seeing the social media guys in Tel Aviv, which is a very different world. So was this very in direct comparison also now in the process of choosing or making? Did they go forward more in a professional way of visualization, or what is the difference in image, in seeing also their daily life experience and photographing them?
Right. Well, I mean, it's interesting. When I'm looking at it now, I see like the sandwich and the girl lying on the table who is a photographer, the cat, things like that. But I think they were documenting the office life mostly, which I thought was very interesting. But also they were going home as well. So it's a little less personal, I think, maybe, than just because it's the office. But it's also something I would never see otherwise. I mean, like the stockholders meeting or whatever that one is with the names on the chairs. Or looking through the keyhole. I mean, some of them are more complex, I think, than some of these more direct images. And there are, there is a still life there. And the sandwich, I guess, is a still life as well. But I don't know. How do you see them differently? Because you're the curator.
No, we are also trained to do a lot of images in social media. So I was curious about this. It's on one hand, it's typical. On one hand, it's not so typical. It's not really Insta photography. It's different. I think you feel that it comes out of a process, and it's quite conscious to do something that you would not put in the social media directly.
Right.
It's more personal, I would say, and a bit more thoughtful. I would like to come back to a very interesting thing you said about the project This Place. You said you've been eight times to Israel to do this.
I think so, probably. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it was an extraordinary opportunity to be able to do that. You know, I mean, it was over like 2.5 years, I think. To be able to have that distance, go be there for, 3 or 4 weeks and then leave. And I think for most of us, or a lot of us like to work that way in the project. And I think that was very, very helpful, that being able to afford doing that.
So how did you get introduced into the society and the country on site? How did, was there something prepared from the project side or?
Oh yeah, when we first went for our exploratory mission that we all sort of joke about now, but there we went. We had a people we met, places we visited. And then we would be, together, the photographers, and, we would be able to talk about the things that we were seeing and what we thought. But yeah, and I think since it got looser as time went on, we were the guinea pigs.
because I think it's very important to mention the, how Frederick Benner designed this. This project, inviting people for Frederick also coming from outside, mm-hmm. somehow, mm-hmm. and yeah. then to introduce them into the country and the society. So there were, I guess, I heard about several dinners with people. You mm-hmm. met people from yeah. society. Everyone had his assistant, who was a student himself, herself, on an art school, mm-hmm. and so as I learned now talking to different photographers, so it was a very broad preparation of this. Again, a bit when you've been traveling through Israel with the in the beginning, what was for you the most striking? What you saw about on society, on places where you've been surprised. Have you been before to Israel before this project?
No, I hadn't. My experience had been working in Morocco and Saudi Arabia, so that's what I was coming from, I guess. Going from place to place, I felt very uncomfortable in the beginning. It's like, that's why I ended up in Nazareth, because, I liked the way it looked, I liked the food. I mean, I was trying to find some place where I felt comfortable, because there were so many differences. And it wasn't, yeah, so that's, it's not a surprise that I decided to embrace that and find as many differences as I could to understand that as much as I could. And I don't think, for me, I'm not somebody, when I go someplace, I don't read anything until like I'm there and I'm in it and I'm with people. So I can balance what I'm reading or what somebody, an expert, is telling me with what it's like for me on the ground. So, I don't know if that answers your question.
more or less. And was it at one point, did you face any restrictions? I know that in the beginning it was a very mm-hmm. open approach, but did you then feel on site that some things are just not possible to do?
No, I didn't feel that anything was not possible. I mean, the only thing was working with a very. I wanted one place I wanted to work was with a girls' school of Orthodox girls. And it was a very big school, and they were learning basically how to be caregivers. And it was very. And there were a lot of people, a lot of handicapped kids that they were working with, and it's a very interesting situation. And they wouldn't let me. But other than that, that was it, really. But it was difficult in the beginning trying to figure out all of us the project, what we could do and what we couldn't do. But once that was sort of sorted out, I would say it was one of the easiest, if not the easiest, place I've ever worked.
Mm-hmm. How was it with the other artists? You've been a group of 12 or even 15.
Yeah,
there are some unknown
coming and going.
not survivors.
Yeah.
How was this working in a group with 12 artists, 12 ego artists traveling through Israel looking for places and interesting motifs? What did happen on this journey?
For me, it was great. I mean, I didn't, you know, I don't have the same axe to grind as other people do, I think. And people were very helpful to me, and I learned a lot. You know, I think we learned a lot from each other, but there definitely were fireworks, and, you know, people had their position, and I guess I was sort of more the trying to be the go-between, and but it was, it was really, really interesting, and I think we all genuinely cared for each other and were happy to have worked with each other.
Is there one of the projects of the other photographers you would highly recommend to see or get deep into? It? No, more than the others, definitely. But just to see if there is one we really are... or two, let's say two.
Well, no, it's just, you know, there are people who are my friends. And that's more like it. But I mean, I like Fazel's work a lot. I mean, I think he and I
just the Fazel Shaikh's work is the one you even see it through here in the entrance room with these aerial pictures of the desert. Yeah,
and I mean, for me, I like that because I knew Fazel already, and I thought he took a big leap with his work in that project, and I think for me that's what was interesting when I saw people, you know, take on new ideas or change, and I think definitely he did.
It's a very different approach than your one, mm-hmm. I would say. No, flying over the desert and taking pictures, than to to be with the people and let them work and to get.
Well, he kept trying to get me to come up in the plane with him, but I was too scared.
You did or you did not?
I didn't.
No, you didn't. Okay.
No.
So I'm very happy that one of the guides from the museum is here, who does the guided tours here in the museum. There is Sasha, and I would like to open up the conversation and ask her to tell about the experience with the visitors in this room. So, and that would be very kind. Do we have a mic in the room? Yeah, thank you.
Oh, this is my biggest group, you know. I never had 50 students in one room. Wow. Thank you, Wendy. This is the room that I think always resonates very intensely with the audience, especially with young audience, because that is the place where they finally feel their opinion is very relevant, because they could have taken those pictures. So there is always a lot of recognition. People being like, oh, I know this is Justin Bieber or Lady Gaga.
Right.
Or if we have some Arab students, then they might say, well, at my household, this looks exactly like this. So I can say, like, pedagogically, this is very, very approachable. People resonate. It's emotional for them. And then it comes the point where there is no clear authorship in a way. So when we arrive to this room, we probably have talked about two artists already, and it is about what we see, but also who is talking about it, is there is a title, and here the whole authorship is kind of dissolved between those communities. So I think it's a very valuable approach also for the visitors, especially for young visitors, to see that conceptualizing is already an authorship, and then in the creative work we can actually be even more representative if we give the tools to the people. And and I also have my story with this room because it was the first time, and whoa, okay. You know, when you have a tour, so you have 60 minutes, so you're supposed to like cover four or five artists, before, let's say, and I can never pick up a picture here. This is impossible. Yeah. So then eventually, with a group of guides who we work with, we came to this idea that, well, actually, it was Andy, my dear colleague from the education department. So we thought, we'll let the people maybe dwell in the room for some 3-5 minutes. Then they close their eyes, we come together, and then they open their eyes and they say, well, I remember that picture. And that is, and maybe then they will introduce what is resonating. So I think in this work, it is a lot about what I know from my life and how, in which way I here in Berlin can now connect to people who were then taking those pictures. And then my personal appreciation, there are so many just really completely weird things, like really strange photos that you would never even, post on Instagram, I would say. And then, boom, you see it here in the museum, so you have to look at it. It has a certain aura, and this is what I really, it's the most punk thing, I think, in the whole exhibition here.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this insight. Are there questions from the audience to Wendy? It's a unique opportunity to know a bit more about this process. There is one in the first row.
Thank you very much for this very innovative form of exhibition of photos. These 14 different places, did they have contacts from one to the next one, or was it only you who was in that, for example, here in Nazareth or in this in Tel Aviv in the social school? Was there any interaction between these different 14 groups? And because your work in America is Appalachians, there I had the impression that there was something learning by the two communities. They could understand each other perhaps better. Was there any similar effect?
Well, not as much maybe as... yes. I mean, actually, the groups that I work with, they don't come together as they're working. But like in South Africa, for example, we had an exhibition, so the two groups came together, and there was some, we had to massage that, and then they kind of got through it, and it was okay. In this case, it was more difficult because there are more, groups. But also, there were people who actually couldn't come to... We had an exhibition at the Tel Aviv Museum. And so there were some groups that were able to come together. But the big thing, I think, is that people seeing the pictures of the other groups and seeing themselves with the other groups, which I hadn't really, really thought about. But it is something that you just wouldn't see in reality. So in that sense, that, having, because we did do a book of, a big book of all these things, and all the communities have the big book. So I think, most of like the people in Hebron, they were very honored to be in the, book with other very different people from them. I can't say that was so much the true on the other side, but I think in this case it's the pictures rather than actually them being together, because it really goes, it's very difficult for them to be together in the same place. I mean, not to be able to get to the museum. I mean, it was difficult for some of them, and And there were, you know, the others like the girls who never came.
So it, there were some restrictions for the participants to have a complete view of the entire project.
But so the book made that possible because we, you know, and everybody, you know, all the communities got books. So,
yeah.
There were two questions, or perhaps,
And then you. Thank you. I actually want to follow up on this. So we're from Israel, and we were here last week with my partner's daughter, who grew up in the Galilee, and she came into this, and we thought this was fantastic, as was your conversation right now. And so, you know, she started looking around, and we said, okay, so which one do you feel most at home in? Mm-hmm. Where do you think this is closest? And after looking around, she ended up with these two here in the Arab side. Mm. Right now, she grew up in the Galilee. She's Jewish, This is where she felt at home.
That's interesting.
And this got me thinking that, you know, there's a way in which choosing the communities in this way. So we live in Jaffa, for instance, where, again,
it would be very difficult
to box people in.
Yeah.
But there is a way in which the community, in a way that this, the way this is curated, don't you feel that actually people got boxed into their community, but in fact there may be more of the crossings that were asked about in their daily lives?
Yes, yes. No, I totally agree with that. Yeah. The boxing in part was what I wanted it to feel like, but what was really hard to do was like it was like a piece of furniture in which you put the pictures on, you know, not to have frames around it, but you know, for processes of, I guess, hanging them and protecting the pictures, the frames became, you know, more a part of it than they probably should have been. So, but yeah, I totally agree with you. Going from place to place, there are so many things that are similar, and that's, you know, and that's what makes you feel sad sometimes. Or what?
Or hopeful.
Oh, yes, 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 yeah, 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 exactly. Yeah.
I have sadly never been to this place, to Israel or the region. And I think when I came in here, what struck me was that I had probably expected more political photos, or at least ones which I perceived as being political. Perhaps some of them are, and I miss it. I just don't see it. But they don't seem to be to me. And I think that's what I found so moving about this room, that the photos felt incredibly intimate because they were pictures of people's everyday lives, which in some ways are not so very different from my everyday life. And what I wanted to ask you was whether, A, you steered it that way at all, because you obviously had a huge selection to choose from. Mm-hmm. Maybe you were drawn more towards the more everyday pictures of animals and food and little sort of shrine-like places in people's houses, whether that was the case, or if that was not the case, whether you were at all surprised that apparently not very much political material came out of it, and it was really much more just people's everyday lives which they wanted to take photos of.
Well, that's a good question. I can answer it pretty directly talking about the pictures from Hebron, for example. When I first went there, I was asked by the it's a project called the Children of Settlers, something like that. And the children who were affected by the settlements. And so when I went to meet them, there were two guys who were watching the TV, and in this place where they have workshops, and you know, it's very, very political, but rightly so, because the army is surrounding them. I mean, it's impossible for them not to be, really. Anyway, these two guys were watching the TV, and as soon as I came in and they saw me, they turned the channel to a pro-Palestinian something on the TV. And so it was really hard for me to talk about. I didn't want this to be political. So that's the only time I dealt with this. I said, I want to know about your lives, because these kids were somewhat programmed, you know, in front of people like me anyway, to, you know, give a certain viewpoint and story. And I wanted to know deeper what was going on with them. And but the other ones, that wasn't an issue. But if you look hard, it's in there. You know, like those are the martyrs in the middle of that, of the Nazareth one. You know, you sort of have to look hard. But that also, I think, is really interesting as well, that if you, you know, that I want people to look deeper than that, what they already know, and then, which is the politics. Anyway. Leave it at that. Yeah.
I have also a question about photography as a tool. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. My question is about photography as a tool. I mean, when you started out your work with the kids, you started in a time where photography was not available for everybody, or you still were working on films. So, and times have changed so much, mm-hmm. especially in the last years. Like, everybody mm-hmm. has a smartphone. Everybody takes pictures all over the day. So, and do you think the kids have changed their awareness of the power of photography? Or what do you think? Do they use photography as a language? Or do you know in which direction?
I think... I always like to say that I think it's a little bit dangerous to say everybody has a smartphone or everybody, you know, takes pictures all the time, because there's still a lot of people who don't, you know, and those are some of the people that I've worked with, so I'm more conscious of it. But also, I think that it has changed. Yeah, it has changed. And for me, it was difficult, because I had to change my language, really, because my language also had to do with developing film and making prints and all that. That was really an important part of, you know, learning to see. But also, with digital cameras, you can do a lot more. You can move distances. You can take more pictures. You can change them. You can, you know... So it is a different kind of language, and I was grateful for this project, because there was so, as I said, there were so many pictures that came out of it that I had to begin to look at pictures in a new way. But that doesn't really answer your question, but I think that I think it's interesting. I mean, I think it's also important to break a language that's become, you know, like selfies and the people copying each other as well. So that's interesting to me.
My question just connects to this, what you said, because I'm like a fan for you for several years. I like your work very much. And for me, it's like a miracle how you manage to give the tools to the people to make this intimate pictures, not copy pictures we can see everywhere, to make just their pictures. And for me, that's the great work you do, and I can see it in every picture here. And yeah, that's my question, how you manage to do this.
Well, thank you. Well, you know, this was sort of like designed to say, okay, look at, here's this little country, but these big differences, and you know, they're not all visual, but they are there, and it was a unique opportunity to be able to look at a whole country, and. I guess I think that what's really difficult for me is you know, thinking about the, you know, a grand plan that is different from a, you know, because the place is different, so that it comes out of the place. Let's see, what else was I going to say? But also to look at things conceptually, not only because of the medium, because of the place, because of the time, because of how I am or what I've done before, and a lot of times, like 3/4 of the time I'm working, I'm thinking, oh, damn, I really fucked this up. I can't see anything. This is not working. I'm not asking the right questions. I'm not thinking in the right way. And then something happens. And I say, oh, okay, now I understand. Some of what, and it may be, you know, one image or a series of images, something unlocks for me what I'm looking at. I mean, that's not completely done, but it's a very nerve-wracking process. It's not easy. Yeah.
Thank you also from my side. I have a question concerning the work within the group. So when you edit and choose pictures, does everybody get his picture from a group? Like, do you see that all feel they were appreciated as part and voice of this group and that everybody is shown here?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't think completely, but I certainly try to do that to a certain extent, but also it's really important how everything fits together. And there were so many pictures here that I really sort of, in a way, I have more control usually. But there are so many pictures, and this could have been, we could do many exhibitions, you know, take all these pictures out and then start again. So in a way, it becomes a bit random because of the amount. But then, on the other hand, you know, that's interesting too, the kind of randomness of it. But certainly within the process, and we did exhibitions in many of the places themselves, and it's certainly in those contexts everybody was included. And I also made those online books for the different communities, which of course everybody was included in. So whether, you know, whether it happens here is not quite as crucial as within the community, I think.
I have a question. It's a very practical question. Mm-hmm. Because when we started to learn about how to install this in the frames and so, mm-hmm. then we learned they were not fixed, these pictures. Mm-hmm. So they are loose. Like, you can take them away, not at the end, not. So it's my colleagues, my restorer colleagues. I see one of them also sitting there. Found a very good system to fix them, so they were not fixed.
Oh, really?
Yeah, there. You can't take them, and so because they are also exchangeable. Just to add on what you said, so if some would disappear, we would mm-hmm. have some on stock to replace them. But do you know from some of the motifs, some of the pictures that disappeared in other shows, or do people touch or not? Like, get.
I have never heard about it if they do, and I never had to replace any, and then there's more than, I mean, yeah, no, not, I mean, I think I would have heard about it if that had happened. And I know in, like, New York, they had tape like this around it where they thought that was going to prevent people from going inside the tape.
That's, we discussed also the tape version.
That seemed ridiculous to me, but, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, right.
That we might be allowed to sort of take them and have a look. And I actually asked one of the, I didn't have a guide on that occasion, I actually asked if we were allowed to touch them. She said, no. And then I felt very silly. But was there any intention? Because also the way they're displayed, they're not displayed evenly. So, there are bigger gaps between, and so I just presumed that people were taking them, having a look, popping them back. Was that deliberate or...
Okay. The one thing that was deliberate is, and I think you probably knew this, is that I didn't want to. I wanted the curators of the different places to be able to put them in the orders they wanted. I mean, these weren't in any order, as far as I know, And I thought that was important and also interesting to me to see how people would do it differently. And because of the horizontal and the vertical, I didn't want to be bound by that and how they were put up, by something that was so formal, I guess. I don't think so. I mean, we figured that it would be easy enough to make to change one. Now, I do have one thing to say, though. The picture of Palestine that's back there is a really a vertical, and it's in there as a horizontal.
Okay, we're gonna change this. Tomorrow.
Okay. And fortunately, one of your lovely staff pointed out that there had been a question about it, so I was glad. I didn't see it, but okay. It's true.
There is another question? Yeah.
I'd like to hear more about the process of finalization of this presentation here. So did you start simultaneously in your studio or wherever and had these 12 frames and then exchange them, and how much source material you had to come down to the final, or let's say it was not final, but it's, you said it's random, but at least decided it's okay. What's the proportion of the pictures you had to the presentation here?
Well, this was really the difficulty for me, is doing this. We also did a book which is, has many more pictures in it and material in it, and also has the titles and, has so much more to it. So this was hard, and we knew that we could only have about 30 pictures per square, or not square, but box, and then I had to, make the text smaller, everything smaller. So I started really with the book in my mind. That's what was important to me. But then I knew that I had to make something that would work with everybody else. And we thought about a lot of different kinds of presentations, like, a slide presentation or something like that. But I liked the idea of having them so that it looks like they're, on somebody's bureau. And this kind of morphed into that as a formal representation of that, which, as I said, is not as, it's good, it's fine in here, and it's good within this exhibition. I think it really works within this exhibition. But if I were to do an exhibition of this work, just of this work, I probably would do it, I might do it differently. And what else did you ask?
Just about the quantity of...
Oh, yeah, that was just so hard. It's like I would spend a long time, like I would spend a half a day with each kid, just looking at their pictures and then, then choose some, bring them back, have them write titles on them, which was important too, so that we were doing this kind of together. And then there was another edit after that, and then there was, a curator... who was curating, everything in the show. And then there was all this idea of these different colors because I wanted to make sure that people could, if they could read it, that there were, and then this kind of went by the wayside, but which were closer to Israel and which were closer to Palestine. So, which meant the flags and, you know, there were all these little things that we tried to put in so that you could read them if you could. But there was like, you know, like, I don't know, there were maybe, if there were, there was probably about 5,000 for each group, maybe, images. So, you know, it's a lot of looking, because it was a lot of good work. It wasn't all mistakes or anything like that. Yeah.
So I'm really interested in this evolutionary, kind of the evolution of the process and what you said about these, that how hard it is too, that because you get blocked and you think you're doing the wrong thing and nothing is happening and you mm-hmm. get stuck and mm-hmm. and then suddenly something opens up. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a really interesting process because there's something mysterious about the actual result because it's based on so much work and very practical work and choices and discussions and meetings and traveling and looking at landscape and looking at people. And then there's the next stage where you have to actually deal with the results of what mm-hmm. you've created with these groups. And I just think it's I want to come and look again now after this talk because I think there are so many mysterious moments in the photographs, and each one tells a story, of course. But it's all part of this process which you were talking about, and how things suddenly drop from heaven, sort mm-hmm, of, mm-hmm. and you go, oh, yes, mm-hmm. that's how I proceed. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really interesting.
Yeah, and I think it's really interesting for me to look at the work of one person, you know, deeply, because then that leads to the next person. But you can see so much. I mean, we all have our own sense of composition that has to do with our, you know, surroundings, but also, you know, our own vision. And I just feel really lucky to be able to see that. And I can remember the first time seeing that when I was working in Kentucky with this girl, Denise, who was just a spectacular photographer and still is. And, you know, if I didn't get to see so many pictures taken by her, I might never have that opportunity. Or so many pictures taken in Nazareth, I wouldn't get that opportunity. So it does feel like things are coming down.
Yeah, so in a way the process actually leads you as well. You're following mm-hmm. your own. Mm-hmm. Once you recognize that, then it's really exciting. I mean, that's the feeling I get.
Yeah.
And then you want to, it's sort of like a drug or something mm-hmm. also.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's not that different from any artistic process, really. It's
yeah, but a lot of people decide I'm going to do this, and then they do it. And this
yeah, but
is
there's
different.
A lot of anguish to what most of yeah. us do.
How much do you show from yourself as an artist when you work with this group? I mean, how important is it that they trust you, that you are like a big artist knowing about framing and so on? Or another way to put my question, what is the difference between a like more of an art didactic project and you as an artist working within these groups?
There isn't any difference. I mean, it's all one thing. Mm-hmm. It took me a long time to understand that.
Mm-hmm. So you take yourself back as an artist, just being
No.
No.
No, because what I'm seeing, everything I see, you know, is for me as an artist. And, you know, I respond. Mm-hmm. I was trained in art school and blah, blah, blah. But I try not to let that affect me, but to see things fresh as much as I can. And that's why it's so difficult for me for a while until all of a sudden I can see that new thing.
And how do you introduce yourself when you introduce you to these groups?
I say that I've been working with people in communities for 50 years and the different places I've worked and and sometimes I show them pictures, but not that often, less and less often. Or I find pictures that have been taken within their context.
Thank you.
So, last question there.
A very direct question to this, that you do not show your own pictures, mm-hmm. but do you show work of other photographers to talk about photography as such?
For example, in Mexico, when I was starting out, I did show them pictures of particularly another photographer, that Mexican photographer, and we looked at the pictures, and what I remember most is one of the kids said to me, "Why are you showing us these pictures? Is this because these people are morally superior?" He didn't say superior, but another kind of word. But are we supposed to be learning morals from these pictures? And I just think everybody has different ideas about pictures, and why you should look at pictures, and you know that's really fascinating. But I think it was better if I'd shown him pictures of New York, for example, or it's more the subject matter in a way than anything, I think.
I was wondering about the time frame when you got into this project. Did you have, were there any specifics in terms of how long this was going to go on for?
Oh,
or did that just
yeah.
kind of, you
That's
know,
a very
just
good
gradually
question.
Develop? And
yeah.
And also, I was wondering what happens afterwards when you, leave these communities. How do you set them up, or I don't know, do you do anything to so that people don't just feel abandoned or
Yeah, it's different in different places. This was really hard because there were so many different groups. With the elderly women, for example, I gave each one of them the camera that they were using, and that was very important for them because they were going on to take more pictures. And they also decided they wanted to teach other elderly women. So that's the best case scenario. But a lot of them got their cameras, or one girl who took amazing pictures in that frame there. Her mother, I gave her. I came back after, I was trying to remember, she made something for me. But I came back to give her and the community books, and then I gave her a camera. I mean, wherever people really wanted a camera, I made sure that they could get it, either it was to a community where they could borrow it or personally or whatever. So I do try to do that as much as I can. Have left dark rooms, places, and the discs in the case of these projects so that they had the photographs.
Is that easier now that there's digital photography? Yeah?
Yeah, it's much easier. Yeah, it's not it's not so much an issue. It's really wonderful.
So thank you. There's a urgent last one? No, okay. So we can have this in private later. So again, thank you very much, Wendy, for this very interesting insights in your project and in the whole project. For us, it's a very important room for us, so we also wanted to give him a very important space in the exhibition. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you to all of you.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Yeah.